So we continue with our discussion of the Ajami story. We did till the 10th text of the 3rd chapter. We review of what has happened till now. In the 1st chapter, there was a philosophical discussion about how people can become free from sins. And in answer, Shukadeva Goswami talks about atonement, then he talks about vimarsana, then he talks about bhakti. And he says bhakti is the best. And in connection with that, he tells the story of Ajamil. And the story of Ajamil actually starts from the middle, where this kind of Ajamil, he goes out and he has a fall. And then after that, how the Yamudas come, and the Yamudas are about to take them away, and that time Vishnu does stop it. There's a conversation. And basically, the conversation centers on what is dharma. And the Yamudas are refuted by the Vishnudas. Vishnudas, then they release the Ajamil, who then performs those strategies, gets purified. And ultimately, the Vishnudas come again and they take him to Vishnu. Then Prajit Maharaj asked the question, what happened? So that time when the narrative stopped, they were saying, it said that the Yamudas went back to Yamaraj. So what happened when they went to Yamaraj? That's what he asked. So the Yamudas express their confusion and frustration. This is how your orders have been countermanded. This has never happened before. How did this happen? Who is the ultimate controller? And then they ask you this question about, if there are multiple controllers, how will dharma be administered? And then, so he said, please explain to us if you think in a meditation. So then the 11th text we discussed last was that in this way when they asked, Yamaraj is very pleased because he will distribute the 11th text. Iti devasa apushta.
Iti devasa apushta.
Praja samyamano yama.
Praja samyamano yama.
So Akrishna, when you ask him this, Yasamyamano, so that refers to the, he is made known by the name of the place he was living, I mean the king of Samyamano, Jesus kingdom. So Samyamano, the Lord of Yama, Prita, he was pleased because he now had a opportunity to speak about the Supreme Lord. And thus, he remembered the Supreme Lord, Smaran Padam Pujimari, and he started speaking. So here, largely, the meter for Yamudu Ramdad's speech is a longer Bhagavatam meter. Otherwise, sometimes we have the Bhagavatam meter of the verse also. Yamuvacha
Yamuvacha
Paromadanyo Jagatastas Tushascha
Paromadanyo Jagatastas Tushascha
Otam Srotam Patavadhyat Ravishma So Paromadanyo, the question had begun with, is there anyone superior to you? So yes, Paro, superior to me, Madanyo, someone different from me is there. Jagatas Tastushascha. Jagatas here refers to the moving and non-Jagatas Tastushascha basically refers to the moving and the non-moving. Basically, the typology of moving and non-moving is used in the Bhagavatam to convey the totality of existence. So, all existence, he is in control. Otam, Otam, Patavatetra Vishwam. So, how does he pervade and control the universe? It's like if we have a cloth, now we just get cloth ready made. But traditionally the cloth was made using hand loom. Then it's understood that it has all round thread, there's vertical thread. And all those threads together comprise the cloth. And we may see the cloth, but the cloth would have no existence without the threads, the vertical and all of those threads. So like that, the whole of existence is sustained by the Supreme Lord. He is the basic sustainer. Amshato Siddhi Janasha Yasya Amshato. By those Amshas, portions, Siddhi Janmanasha. So the maintenance, the instruction, and the creation is done by them. This Amsha refers to the Guna Avataras, Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh. There is Amsha, he maintains it all. Nasya Odava Yasya Vashim Chiruha. Nasya Odava. Nasya is in the nose. Odava is by a robe. This is an oxen is tied by a rope and is controlled. similarly, all of existence is controlled by him. So there is the broad understanding. This is a standard example. This will be elaborated on the next two verses also, about how the way an oxen is controlled through the nose,
through a ring in the nose, or through a rope into the nose,
basically. That's how the Lord is in control. And we elaborate this metaphor a little bit more. But before that, let's look at the other metaphor of the cloth. What does it mean literally? Sometimes people have the idea that, people ask the question, does God exist? It's a valid question. If we think of God as some person who
exists in some remote part of the universe,
or some person who had descended on this earth long ago. But if you understand the basic definition of God, Sarvakaranakaran, the cause of all causes, then God is the one whose existence makes all existence possible. So if God did not exist, nothing would exist. We just understand the definition of God, then that would mean that God's existence makes all existence possible. Without it, nothing would exist. So to ask whether God exists is to ask whether a circle is circular. A circle, by definition, is circular. There is no meaning to a circle without circularity. Similarly, there is no possibility of existence without God's existence. So that's why we are normally, especially when we conceive of God as a deity in the temple, or people see forms, then what happens when we see God as a form? Certainly God has a form. And the highest manifestation of God is as a form. But when we see him as a form, what happens is that he appears to be a portion of existence. There's a big temple hall, or there's a big community, in which in one part there is God present. So when we see God in a particular form, we think of him as a portion of existence. And then, okay, this portion may exist, this portion may not exist. The rest of existence is going to make a difference. But actually, this God has multiple manifestations. And at his highest manifestation, he is existing as a person. But he is not the portion of existence. He's not a portion of existence. He is the foundation of existence. So without him, nothing could exist. And that's why we have Matsthani Sarvabhutani. In 9.4c, Krishna says that Matsthani, all living beings exist in me. So when we see the form of the Lord, that is actually that is not the manifestation of the Lord to sustain the universe. He's a transcendental manifestation existing in the spiritual world, the Bhagavan manifestation. We have the Paramatma and the Brahman, which sustain the universe. So God is the one who sustains all existence. Without his existence, no existence would be possible. In this verse, we have 9.4. Mayamadatamidam sarvam jagadavyaktamurtina matsthani sarvabhutani najaham teshu asthita. So this verse actually talks about the three manifestations of the Absolute Truth. Mayamadatamidam sarvam jagadavyaktamurtina. A and B. First two lines talk about the Brahman manifestation. By being man manifest form, the whole universe is pervaded. Matsthani sarvabhutani. All existence is sustained in me. That refers to Paramatma manifestation. Nacham Deshwastata. I do not exist in that. That is the Bhagavan manifestation. It's like one capsule to describe all of the manifestations. So if we consider God is all these three together. So if we think of God only as the form, that can also become convey to us a conception of God as limited. So Otam Protam Patavakta Vishwam. He is the foundation of all existence. Without him, nothing could exist. So, right, these amshas make all of it, creation and destruction, they take care of that. And by him, he controls all the lokas. Now, how does he control? We'll look at that in the next verses. Verses 13. Yo nama eva chi janam jayam.
Yes, we believe in the name of karma.
Maharaj Janam Nijayam.
Janam Nijayam. In this place, all the beings that exist,
they have their names, they have their order, or whatever names, forms, manifest in this world, Vacha. Vachi, through the words of the Vedas, but Nati Gantrami Vedana Mamedra. Just like somebody bound by a rope, Ga. Here, Ga can refer to cow, can refer to ox, more as a deal. That just as a rope can bind an animal, similarly, all living beings are bound by the Veda. Yes, my Vadimta Ime Nama Mamedra. And everybody, they are meant to offer tribute to it. They are meant to surrender to him, they are meant to dedicate themselves to him, even the Vardhar Chitta Vahanti. And they offer tribute to him out of fear. Now, we may say there are so many people who do so many godless things. And how are they offering tribute to the Lord? How are they controlled by the Lord? So, this is talked about in 9.6, where Krishna says, Vidha akash kumityam vayu sarva prabhoman, vidha sarvani bhutani, athani pyopadhare. He says that all living beings are controlled by me, are restrained, they rest in me just as the wind rests in the sky. The wind has some capacity to move, which it has a huge capacity to move. But still, if you conceive of the sky as upside down globe, upside down bowl, then the movement of the air is not restricted, but the area of the movement is restricted. So, like that, all of us have free will. But the scope of the free will is restricted. So once we get a human body, we cannot fly in the air like a bird. We cannot swim in the water like an aquatic. We might be able to swim, but not with as much proficiency as an aquatic. But we cannot make any bird sounds unless occasionally we can make a few sounds. But usually the body itself puts a certain amount of limitation on what we can do. And beyond that, everything that we do that produces some reactions, and those reactions will bind us. So the reactions come at multiple levels. So we have freedom. So just like the person in the 10th story of a building, the person has the freedom to walk out of it. But if that person walks out, so what is bound is that we have choice, but we have the freedom to choose. But we are bound by the linkage of choices and consequences. The choices, we can't determine the consequences after we make the choices. Once I walk out of a 10-story building, I am going to fall. So we have the freedom to choose, but once we make a choice, the consequences are there. And we can't avoid those consequences. As I say, we can't break the laws of God, we can only break ourselves against the law. We can't break the laws of God. If I think I will jump off the 10-story building, I will break the law of gravity. No, I only break myself against the law. So, through the laws of material nature, in some ways there is an immediate limitation in terms of what we can do and what we can't do. But beyond that, there is limitation in terms of we cannot just do anything and wait a minute. We will get consequences sooner or later. So, just like the example of some animal being bound by a rope is significant because a bondage to a rope does not make the animal motionless. It does not make the animal completely frozen. This bound by a rope, it has the capacity to move. So like that, we also have some freedom. But freedom, the scope of the freedom is limited. And different living beings may have different scope of freedom. So depending on the kind of karma that they have had in the past, we may have different levels of freedom. But ultimately, we are bound. And it is bound by chains of names and actions. Nama Deva, Chinnam Nijayam. That means, once we get a particular body, get a particular name, we have a particular kind of activities. And in that way we are bound. The soul is free. When the soul gets into a dog's body, the soul has to act like a dog. Soul gets into a bird's body, the soul has to act like a bird. So in this way, so if we look back originally, we don't have the time to do a words by words correlation between the exact discussion that went on between Anuttas and Vishnuttas and what is going on over here. But essentially their question is that is there some other controller? Anuttas' question is there some other controller? If there are many controllers, then how is Dharma going to be administered? Who is going to punish whom? So the first point that he answers is that actually there is one controller. That is the Supreme. He controls everyone. Then the other question, okay, if there are multiple controllers, then how are the multiple controllers related to the Supreme One? That you will describe now.
Mahendra Nirutti Prachetaha
Mahendra Nirutti Prachetaha
Soma Virisha Pavano Vinci
Soma Virisha Pavano Vinci
Aditya Vishweva Sabodha Sadhya
Aditya Vishweva Sabodha Sadhya
Manutkana Rukrana Sasiddha
Manutkana Rukrana Sasiddha
Capacity to see. then how is that going to apply to the soul and the supreme? The point here is that the form does not have the capacity to see the eyes. So the point here is not consciousness. The point is capacity. So the form cannot see the eyes. Similarly, we cannot see the supreme. We cannot understand the supreme. Not because we don't have consciousness, but because we are finite. Because we are limited. The example is not so much about presence or absence of consciousness. The example is about the limitedness of the capacity or the absence of capacity. So whatever faculties we have, all those faculties we can use to know the world around us, to serve the Lord in this world, to get some understanding of the absolute. But we can never get complete understanding of the absolute. That's why our faculties, they are finite, they are limited, and we cannot understand anything. So now, after describing this position of the Lord, describing the supreme position of the Supreme Lord, now we know that Yamaraja knew about Vishnu, knew about Narayan, but they did not know exactly his supreme position. They thought that they said there are different devatas, different jurisdictions. Narayan also has a jurisdiction. But here we say that he is not just another god. This is another important point. You know, when Prahlad, did I mention this point in last time when I talked? God is not just the best of all beings. He is the basis of all beings. Did I talk about this last time? So you see, this is again, when Prahlad was asked by Hiranyakashipu, from whom are you learned? Who is the source of your strength? So what was the answer?
Source of whatever your source is.
Now, the source of the strength of all living beings, the source of your strength, the source of your strength also, and the source of strength of Brahma also, that is the source of my strength. Now at one level, this might just seem like cheekiness.
You know, it's like you're talking back to someone.
What is the source of your strength? The source of my strength is the source of your strength also. Is he simply talking back over there? No, actually he is making a very profound philosophical point. See, normally, Hiranyakashipu is thinking that there is a hierarchy of beings and Vishnu is somewhere over there. And if I just become powerful enough, I can overthrow Vishnu and I can become supreme. So sometimes you may conceive of there is a hierarchy of beings and God is at the top of the hierarchy. Now this is one way of conceiving God. And for some purposes, it is good. It is useful enough to convey that God is the highest among all beings. But there is a fundamental difference. If you just think of God only in this way, God is the best of all beings. And the problem happens that we think the best is interchangeable. There is a hierarchy. So there is number one tennis player in the world today. Then somebody else can become number one. That person just performs better, wins more matches, that person can become number one. So if you think of God as the best of all beings, and I can also become the best. Somebody else can become best. We think of that as an interchangeable position. So God is not just the best of all beings. He is the basis of all being. All of existence depends on Him. So He is not in the hierarchy at all. He is completely different. So what is the difference? Sometimes, as I said, we may give the analysis in terms of saying Vishnu has 60 qualities, Krishna has 64 qualities, Shiva has 55 and Brahma has 50. This is for a particular method of analysis. The Bhagavatam itself elsewhere states that we can count the number of atoms in the universe, but we cannot count the qualities of the Supreme Lord. So for a particular analysis to understand how Krishna has far more qualities than others have, then that particular analysis may be used. But the definition of God as it is explained in the scriptures is very clear that God is not this hierarchy at all. All other living beings have material bodies. God has a spiritual body. So He is completely outside the hierarchy. So here, by emphasizing that He controls all living beings, the Amshas who may create, maintain and destroy existence, they are all, the beings who may create, maintain and destroy existence, they are His Amshas. Yamaraja is emphasizing that He is a completely different category of being. He is at a different level of existence. And now, he describes further, who were those people whom you encountered? That was a question also which Devadutta had. who was it that you encountered? And now he can answer that. The 17th text.
Followed
when the Yamrutas are, when Gajanam is floating. So basically this answer is four broad aspects. One is the identity of Vishnu, the identity of Vishnu Rutas, the understanding of Dharma, and the application of Dharma in the case of Ajam. That's how Yamaraj answers the question. So Dharmam tu sakshat bhagavat pranitam,
Dharmam tu sakshat bhagavat pranitam,
navai vidur vishayo naupi deva,
navai vidur vishayo naupi deva,
asiddha mukhya sura manushya,
asiddha mukhya sura manushya,
Dharmam tu sakshat bhagavat pranitam. Prabhupada quote this verse quite often. That dharma is what? Sakshat bhagavat pranitam. That dharma is that which is given by the Supreme Lord. Earlier, in the Vishnu, the Amrutas have given a definition of dharma. What does the name remember that? Veda pranihito dharma. There was the Vipariya. So he says that which is given in the Vedas, that is dharma. So that was their understanding of dharma. That is true. But here, Yamaraj is taking their understanding further. It's not just dharma, it's not just a text. Dharma is order emanated from a person. And that person is Vishnu. So they have the idea of law in terms of law codes. Veda pranihito dharma, that is true. But the Vedas themselves come from the Supreme, and important is that it is ultimately the Dharma is the word of the Supreme. Dharmam tu saksha bhagavat pranitam. Whatever the Lord has told, that is Dharma. And this Dharma, it cannot be asserted by other living beings. And again, he gives a list of various living beings. Rishayo naam, so all these beings, and then Uddhyada Charana, none of them can actually understand Dharma. Now this will lead to a paradox. Actually, if we are meant to follow Dharma, and if we can't understand Dharma, then how do we follow Dharma? The point is that there is Dharma as a personal choice of the course of action, and Dharma as a principle. So we all have to choose some course of action and move on, and that's why we will not always make the absolutely right choice. Sometimes we may err also in our choices. And if we err, we do course correction. But dharma in its complexity, dharma in its completeness, we cannot understand it all. So there will always be contextual application of dharma. And some contextual application will be more right than others. Or what will be right will also vary according to time and circumstances. But no one can say that I have complete conclusive understanding of dharma. Said that all these living beings, they also have understand Dharma. Again, the point here is not that we have no understanding of Dharma, but nobody can claim to have a complete conclusive understanding of Dharma. Then it says that further, all these living beings can't understand, but then somebody has to have understanding. Only God understands. God is already accessible. Then how do I understand? Then he talks about the Mahayanas, who have some understanding of Dharma, which is much higher than understanding that others are. So this famous verse about Mahayanas. Swayam Gurunarada Shambhu,
Swayam Gurunarada Shambhu,
Kumara Kapilomanu,
Kumara Kapilomanu,
Prahlado Jinpo Bhishmo,
Prahlado Jinpo Bhishmo,
Balirvayasa Kilvayam,
Balirvayasa Kilvayam,
Vatashaite Vijanimo,
Vatashaite Vijanimo,
Dharmam Bhagavatam Bhata,
Dharmam Bhagavatam Bhata,
Guhyam Vishuddham Durbodham,
Guhyam Vishuddham Durbodham,
Yam Jnatvam Ritamashnate,
Yam Jnatvam Ritamashnate.
So this last line comes in the Bhagavad Gita, Yam Jnatvam Ritamashnate. It's similar. Yam Jnatvam Ritamashnate. So he gives a list of 12 exalted people who understand Dharma. And Vārvaśite Vijānāti, these two understand Dharma, Bhāvatam Bhataha. Oh, Bhataha, Amar Yaya Sarvam, these can understand Dharma. Guhyam Vishuddham Durbodham. He gives three adjectives to describe Dharma. Guhya is confidential, Vishuddham is pure, and Durbodham. It is not so easy to understand. Bodha is to understand. Durbodha is comprehend
and difficult to comprehend or incomprehensible. So dharma is incomprehensible. So this is dharma which we are not studying. And interestingly here, earlier when he was talking about the hierarchy of control, he starts himself and talks about the various living beings. But when he's talking about hierarchy of understand or the list of people who understand dharma, he gives his name the last one. So he is the list of all of them and he also mentions his name in the last. Now, among these 12 Mahajanas, if you see, all of them also have a significant place in the Bhagavatam. Almost all of them, we can learn significant, substantially about them in the Bhagavatam, except for perhaps for Janaka, who was not much talked. But apart from him, all the other people, we know a fair amount of the Bhagavatam itself. So the Bhagavatam not only tells us about Bhagavan, but also tells us about the prominent Bhagavatas. These 12, they know dharma, and if we understand dharma, then we can also attain the immortality. The word guhya is often used with respect to dharma. The Bhagavad Gita says this man is guhya, guhya dharma, guhya dharma. The idea is the confidentiality is primarily a function of responsibility. It is not that Krishna wants to keep the knowledge confidential. It is rather this knowledge is a wealth, it's a treasure, and it is to be entrusted to those who are capable of understanding. So, I'll give you three examples. In today's world, there's a lot of concern that say nuclear power should not be taken by countries which are ruled by hot-headed rulers. You know, if some irresponsible country takes a nuclear power, they can cause devastation. So the point is, knowledge is power. And once power is there, power can be easily abused. This says, we have concern that this knowledge is very powerful, it's regulated. Because that knowledge is responsibility. So Krishna wants to give knowledge of dharma, but at the same time, then the dharma is subtle, it's complex. And it cannot be understood by people who are not mature enough. And that's why there is the dharma. It is the dharma of dharma of the kama. It is the bhagavata dharma. So people in general know about the traiveda dharma. The bhagavata dharma is confidential. And this, so when he says that this dharma, he is talking dharma durbodham, he is not talking about traiveda dharma. That dharma is something that Yadutta also knows. But he is talking about a higher understanding of dharma, which is what this Mahajana was saying. And which is what this pastime is going to stress. So the Yamutas are not wrong in the sense of somebody being like true or false. They are wrong in the sense that they follow a higher level of dharma than a higher level of dharma is applicable. So now we will talk about what is the dharma that they know, that is the special dharma which is Durmodham, the usual few minutes. We have time for question answer. So here also say three words, Pumsam Dharma Para. Three words come here also. And Bhakti Yoga Bhakti. So actually if you read the Bhagavad Gita, there's a resonance. What is told over here is repeated by different people at different times and even different yugas in different contexts. The context is different and that's why there is some difference in the message. The essential message is consistently the same. He continues, Anamocharamahatnyam
Hare Pashyat Putraka
Asamilopiye Naiva
Mrityu
Pa
Namocharama. Just see what is the greatness of this chanting of the name, utterance of the name. Hare Pashyata Putrakaha. You see. So, Putrakaha. Putra refers to a son or child, children. So now the relationship between master and servant, it is very intimate. The king is supposed to be like a father for citizens. So Yamudagar is servant, but he is referring to the affection he has his sons. Putrakaha. Hare Pashyata Putrakaha. Ajamiyo Pienaiva Mutipasha Amuchita. And even Ajamil was sinful, he was Mutipasha, he is free from the shackles, news of death, Amuchita, by Namuchar. So now, normally, when we glorify something, praise something, we have to give some praman, we have to give some evidence or some dharma to substantiate that. So he says, nothing required, universal has seen it. He has seen the potency of the holy name. Bhakti that you were freed from that, from the Bhakti Bhash, someone was freed. And this way, he stresses the potency of the Holy Name. Eta Vadala Nagadirna Nirharna Om Saam Sankirtanam Bhagavato Gunakarma Namna
Sankirtanam Bhagavato
Sankirtanam Bhagavata Gunakarma Karma Namana. And this itself is sufficient. Nothing more is needed. Vikrushi Putram Agavan Yajana Mayopi. And what to speak of? This is what to speak of attentive chanting, even inattentive chanting. I'll refer to someone else. That also was enough to grant liberation to Ajami. So the point is, he's stressing the glory of the Holy Name. And thus he is conveying that this is the, because the Supreme Lord, because Narayan is Supreme, because he is all pure and all powerful, contact with him through his holy name has this tremendous potency to purify. And thus, the Supreme Lord has, thus the Ajami was liberated. Now he talks about, now when they may say that we had a certain understanding of Dharma, what about that conception of Dharma? He talks about that conception and how that conception is not, it cannot match this conception. So, we'll just take a couple of verses, then we can ask a question, answer, then I'll continue.
It seems that
Ajami's
pastime is very, very old. So, it's like his Visma is also an eternal personality.
So, Vishnu is mentioned in the list of 12 Mahajanas, why was it that? The Ajami pastime is supposed to be quite ancient, whereas Vishnu is quite recent. So, from the chronological point of view, if you see that surely the Ajami pastime is narrated by Shukadeva Goswami. So, it must have happened long, long time ago. And Vishnu is just a little bit before Shukadeva Goswami or Sudha Goswami, both of them. So yes, Vishnu, in general, it is described, especially by the Goswamis, that the Lord and his associates, important associates, they are eternal persons. And when the Lord descends, not everyone in his pastimes is an eternal associate. But other people who just happen to be there at that time, they are very fortunate to be associated with the Lord. They may have done some bhakti, they may have done some punya, whatever. But they are not his eternal associates. There are certain gopis who descended with Krishna in his future. And there are some other gopis who are sadhanas. And when they associate with Krishna's eternal associate gopis, they learn, they get training, and then they attain the spiritual. So,
Bhishma is an eternal associate of the Supreme Lord. And he descends with the Lord whenever the Lord descends. And in that sense, he, when he is referring to Bhishma as one Mahajana, he is not as a referring to Bhishma who is coming in this Kali. That Bhishma can refer to a Bhishma who had appeared in an earlier age. And there also he acted in an exemplary way. Now the exact pastimes were not happening in the exact same way each time. Then you say some differences are there in different yugas. But overall, the characters behave according to character. The way Bhishma is now, there is a more or less Bhishma will be now here. And that Bhishma, whom he is referred to over here, is also a more of them. Is that true? Any other questions? Yes.
Comparison of Guya to India power, how that
and how is the comparison of, say, confidential knowledge to nuclear power? I'm not talking about nuclear power, I'm talking about the knowledge of nuclear power. That, see, the knowledge to manufacture nuclear weapons. The world leaders don't want it to be available to everyone. There are various kinds of treaties which are made, nuclear non-proliferation treaty and all that, by which that knowledge should not fall in the hands of some intemperate people. So I was talking not so much comparing the nuclear power of the knowledge, I'm talking about principle of certain forms of knowledge being restricted based on responsibility or maturity of people. So similarly, spiritual knowledge, like we have a principle, I do not instruct faithless people in the glories of the holy name. Now, even this Ajanga pastime, if we have to be a little careful, if people have very little faith in God, people are very skeptical about the whole concept of bhakti, and that time we tell them to chant the holy name, all sinful reactions will go away. People will not believe in it, they will think it's very weird. So, we have to instruct people according to their adhikara. Now, if there is a very great devotee, that devotee can create adhikara for people. Because by the devotee, by the one's purity, by one's potency, the devotee attracts faith. And then whatever the devotee says, people can have faith in that devotee. In that teaching also actually. But in general, unless a very exalted devotee is present, to speak confidential principles of dharma is not very appropriate. That's why even Prabhupada, he preached all over the world. But if he did not get into too much the technicalities of Radha Krishna Bhakti or esoteric aspects of body Vaishnavism, he spoke what people needed to hear. So we have to, so guhya means that people have to give knowledge according to their level of maturity. Because acquiring knowledge is a responsibility. And that knowledge, that responsibility, only people are mature enough can take it. Is it clear? Any other questions? So if we say that the Mahajana doesn't understand dharma, isn't that elitist, that knowledge is reserved in some people only? Actually, rather than elitist, we can say it is specialist. Just like any field of knowledge, if I have disease, I have to go to a doctor. And if I have some symptoms, I cannot understand all the symptoms mean. So a doctor is a specialist, the doctor can understand. And further, if I have some heart problem, I may have to go to a cardiac specialist. And if you go deep into fields of knowledge, there are super specialities also. So if I was on a flight from America, so I was met a person. But he is a prenatal cardiac specialist. That means he performs surgery on the heart for babies who are not even born. So, we can have that level of specialization also. So the point is that broadly in principle of medicine, everyone can understand. But even in medicine, we go into deeper and deeper subtle things in that aspect. Then specialization is required. So,
when that speciality becomes an elitist mentality, when that knowledge is deliberately withheld, or it is not shared, and people are deprived of their knowledge. So say, if doctors have some skills or some knowledge, and they charge exorbitantly, they have to charge something, but if they charge exorbitantly, then that becomes, that puts off people. But, so in any field of knowledge we go, there is the specialists who know the certain things are going to be few. So somehow, this idea that even religious knowledge or spiritual knowledge is also as a deep sophisticated body of knowledge. That idea, when people don't understand, because people think that, as people begin with the idea of relativism, if I have a disease, you cannot say that I have my view and you have your view. There is some disease which is there, some disease that has to be treated. So this idea, as far as we function in this world, we always base it on some objective knowledge. If my computer is not working, if one person says, maybe your hardware is fault, somebody else says, no, your brother knows what. Somebody else says, CPU is fault. No, I need one diagnosis on which I can act. And that requires me to do three different people have different diagnoses, and you have to put a bigger expert to resolve it. So like that, there is the chain where more and more specialist knowledge, that you have to go to greater and greater experts. Dharma, Yudhishthira is considered Dharmaraja. So he has a lot of knowledge of Dharma. But even he's concerned with Vishnu, he's hearing from Vishnu. So everybody has knowledge, but people have different levels of knowledge. And it is not religious because they all are ready to share that knowledge with those who approach and seek. Any other questions?
Expressing reluctance to fight.
So Draupadi also makes the point later that actually Yudhishthir gambled only because he was compelled by his elders to do so. So he expresses reluctance to do so. He was compelled by his elders. Compelled means almost forced, instructed by the elders. So Yudhishthir, before this gambling match took place, after the Rajasuya Yajna was performed, and that time the Asatrya made a prediction. And he said, in the future, although you have become the king, you will not enjoy peace. There will be a, in the future, there will be a great war. And that war will establish you as the king. So now, at that time, Vishnu thought that wars are caused by difference of opinion. Wars are caused by dissension. They are caused by disobedience. So he said, I will do my part in avoiding war. And what I will do is, I will always obey my elders. So he was normally always very deferential and respectful to his elders. But in this particular situation, he also became a war that I will obey my elders. That's why when Dhritarashtra called him for the gambling match, he couldn't refuse. So he was simply obeying his elders against his own intelligence and against his own will. He would rather not have gambled. And as he was gambling and losing, again he felt that I have lost everything now. At least whatever little will I have, with that maybe I can gain everything and I can gain things. And I can offer something to those who are my dependents. So that's how he, that's how did he gamble the Pandavas, with other Pandavas? It's not that he was into human trafficking in today's terms. Not at all. He was thinking that, what will they do without anything, without any kingdom, without any arms? If I just gamble, if I just stick on the stage, I'll get everything back. And at least I'll have something. And eventually, then he thought that Draupadi, she's already without a protector. So at that time, his thought was basically that I have to somehow protect my dependents. And unfortunately, the way he acted was that he got them all into the trouble. But his intention was not just to, he was not just caught in the greed of gambling. He was actually doing his duty to his elders, and he was trying to do his duty to those who were under him. That is to protect them. So to have some resources to protect them. So in that sense, he was acting with a dharmic intention. It was not just that he had no greed for quick money because of which he gambled. So in that sense, it was dharmic. Now the specific question, he may say here, this Bhishma is a Mahajan. So Bhishma is a Mahajan, how can he become deluded? How can he say, I don't know about him? So the thing is, that this whole pastime, at a higher level if we see, it's everybody is orchestrated. So Bhishma is saying that, and third alert is, Bhishma is saying that, I don't know these Dharma's Nahi. Now here what has happened is from the Bhakti tradition's perspective, this is Niyamanagraha. Of getting caught in the technicalities of rule without understanding the essential purpose. Yes, whether a woman belongs to her husband or not after the husband is in candle in himself, that is a technicality. The important thing is that how can an honorable woman be dishonored, disrobed, disgraced in a public assembly where there are Hindus present? That is a travesty of dharma. So it's like there are lower level principles which are there in caught in the, okay, these two principles which is higher. But a protection of a woman is a much, much higher principle. And somehow the other she must protect. So basically, this argument Draupadi holds of Draupadi, she's also a Kshatriyani. So she's also very intelligent and resourceful. So, and she's dragged to the assembly. Maybe before she's dragged to the assembly, she raises this question, the messenger who comes and tells her that he will come to the assembly, he says, had Krishna gambled himself, how did he gamble? So it's a valid dharmic question, but ultimately it's a technicality. And what Draupadi is trying to do is, she is buying time and she's trying to push off the calamity that is coming. So Bhishma Pitama, his inability to answer the question, it's basically reflective of the Niyamagraha. That how could he get caught in technicality or forgetting the principle that the woman has been dishonored? The understanding for that is that the Bhagavatam.
His whole pastime is orchestrated to demonstrate how Krishna is the only protector that we have, ultimately.
Draupadi, you know, a woman, usually, you know, if she is alone, going alone somewhere at night or in a forest or somewhere, then she will be attacked and exploited. But if a woman is with her husband, then normally she has a protector. But if a woman has five husbands, how much more? If a woman has five husbands in a public assembly where great people are present. Actually speaking, if we conceive, it is very difficult to conceive of a more protected situation for a woman. But to be with her husband and to be with other great heroes. And yet in such a situation, she was normally very protected. She was that unprotected.
So the whole pastime is meant to demonstrate the principle that actually we have no ultimate protector except Krishna. And the Lord arranges all the characters over there to orchestrate them to act in such a way that this lesson is taught.
So,
Yudhishthira's actions from this perspective. Now, we can also analyze from another lower perspective for some moral edification for ourselves. So, we can also analyze the same. So, if Yudhishthira can, we got into trouble by Yami, what about us? Therefore, we should not Yami. That is also valid level of understanding. That Vishnu Gam, what a technicality, that is also valid level of understanding.
And the highest level of understanding is that actually, this whole pastime is orchestrated, and all the important characters over there, the devotional characters especially, they are orchestrated so that they demonstrate this principle that Krishna alone is our ultimate protector.
So, specifically from that perspective, what Yudhishthira did, it was correct. Because generally speaking, a slave does not have the possessions. But at the same time, even slaves have their families. And if a slave has a family, his wife and his children, they are still under his protection. So they may not be living the same way as, say, the master and his family are living. But usually speaking, it is. So then what happens is, Duryodhana tries to play around. And because Draupadi has raised this question, was Yudhishthira's own master and he gambled me? So then, what he tries to do is, Duryodhana tries to play husband against wife. He says, Draupadi, if you say that Yudhishthira has committed adharma, then I will release all of you. So now Draupadi refuses to take the bait. What did he say? He says, actually, it was only on the instruction of the elders that Yudhishthira gambled. And therefore, it is for the elders to decide what was right and what was wrong. So that although she has been dishonored because of her husband's mistake, still, she does not blame her husband over there. She will not fall for that bait. So the point is that because his intent throughout was darling, it was not greed, it was right. But overall, the whole assembly witnessed catastrophic wrong, and that was why it says asat samhavi, right? It is an impious assembly. And that impiety happened because ultimately through it Krishna demonstrated that he is the only protector. Does that answer your question? Yeah. Any other questions?
Hard when we tell new people, we are not chanting 8 rounds.
there is a fear in the teacher side.
Okay, so initially devotees have difficulty in destroying and complete their arms. So what to do about what to tell you people? How to tell?
See, there are different levels of connectedness with Krishna. And becoming initiated and following the four eight principles, that is one level of connectedness. It is not that people who cannot come to this level of connectedness are not devotees. See, there are bhaktas and there are sadhakas. Now, I am using the word bhakta and it is a very generic sense, not in the nature of the bhaktas. So, anyone who has some devotional disposition towards Krishna, they like to hear Krishna katha, they like to practice any little bhakti, they have some deities at home, or they have some puja at home. They like to sing Hare Krishna mantras, sing Krishna bhajans. They all can be generically classified as bhaktas. We also use the word bhakta, refer to devotees before they get initiated. So, there are bhaktas and then sadhakas. Sadhakas are those who follow in sadhana bhakti structure. A strictly counted, it's what the standards are that are there within the Krishna consciousness movement. So now, even going back to Godhead is a gradual process. It's not necessary that all those chances to down for the universe will surely go back. Prabhupada said that, but we shouldn't think of it as a, it's not like Christians, you accept Jesus as a savior and you want to go back to God. So they accept Prabhupada as a savior and go back to God. The point is that we follow the four principles, chant 16 rounds, and that whole, that sustained practice of bhakti will spiritualize our consciousness. And the spiritual consciousness which we have at the time of death, that is what will take us back to Krishna. So this is the process which we develop the spiritual consciousness. And it is it is like when there is a, say there is a fast trip and there is no brakes. So you know, it's not that if somebody can't get in the fast train, they say, we will stay here only. You know, let them come as no brakes. And even if they take many lifetimes, at least if they are practicing dharma, they are being eliminated. They are being eliminated. So broadly speaking, in our outreach, we should focus on encouraging people to practice bhakti. And what level they practice, we can encourage them to come to higher levels, but we shouldn't make their connection with Krishna dependent on their coming up to a particular student. We can make their connection with Krishna. So, last time also I explained this, we can conceive the Krishna consciousness movement as a set of concentric circles of expanding radii. So it's not that somebody who's folded to the Chinese teachings, an insider, and everybody is the outsider. Not like that. There can be different levels of connectedness. And people who are connected at different levels and are practicing at different levels, they are all moving towards Krishna. And that's how the Vedic culture was. We see that, okay, there are Krishna devotees, there are demigod worshippers, there are impersonalists. You know, and they are all included broadly in the Vedic culture, in the Vedic food. So there is a high standard, but even if, and you see, this Krishna also does this in 12.8 to 12.12. There is a hierarchy of people able to practice at different levels. So people shouldn't be made to feel unwelcome, unwanted, or guilty just because they can't come to particular standards. You know, sometimes there will be people who may just chant a few rounds, but you see, they may have a great service attitude, they may have very good attraction towards Krishna. And they can do a lot for Krishna. But if we alienate them by insisting that they have to do this, 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 then they may not do that service. So we see Prabhupada, one of the things that George Harrison liked about Prabhupada was that Prabhupada never told him to move in. Prabhupada never told him that they have to do this, this, this. Encourage him to practice bhakti. Now he was a Shrestha. But the point is that Prabhupada gives an example of that. So we can try to help people to adjust their schedule so that they can find time. But if they say it's all very difficult, it's not possible, then we don't have to insist on insist that their connection with Krishna depends only on coming up to a particular standard. In the long run, we may also, our movement is in discussion. See, if in India it's so difficult for people to chant, the West is even more difficult. So most of the times in the West, when Western people become devotees,
you know, many of them become connected with Krishna without ever becoming initiated for all of this. He said, they don't stay initiated. And they are well connected with Krishna, they are well connected with devotee, spiritual master also. So maybe in the future, our movement will have some kind of official second level of connectedness. Not so much as an initiation, cannot have initiation at a different level than that, but there will be some level other, like we have something like whether the devotees come, whether they are chanting a particular round in the Prabhupada Ashray or say Guru Ashray, so there are stages like that. Something like that may come up in future, where it may not be movement wide everywhere, but it may be in some place, for whatever way also. But the point is, we have to encourage people to connect with Krishna. And whatever level of connectedness that is suitable for them, we should encourage them, not discourage them just because they can't come to that, come to a higher level of standard. Does that answer your question? Any questions? It's only my... So it's my 25th text. प्रायेण वेदतं नमः
जिनोऽयम्
देव्याविमोहितमतिर्पटमायालम् त्रयाम्यलिकृतमतिर्मधुपुष्पितानाम् वैतान्के महति कर्मायुज्यमानः So, prayana, most people, they are Vedvatanda Mahajanoyan. That Vedana, they don't know. And interestingly, those who don't know, the Bhagavatam is not using the word Durjan for them. The word Mahajan is used even for others who do not know the Dharma. The word Mahajan is not in a restricted category. It is a name. There are also other great people who also know about, not know about this. So we see that Krishna also talks about this. I think in 18.3, he 18.345 in that section. What happens is, he says there are some people who say that yagyanartha karma, natyajyam yagyanartha karma, natyajyam vichavare, tyajyam dosham yeke karma prahu manishi. Karma. So basically, some people say Yagyanartha should be given up, others say Yagyanartha should not be given up. So Krishna talks about these two categories. When he's talking about this, he says, and he eventually says that Yagyanartha should not be given up, you should do one's prescribed ways. But even when Krishna is referring to the Purva Paksha, those whose opinion he doesn't agree with, those who say they are wrong, he says that they are not right eventually. But still, by telling them, he refers to them as Manishina. Yagyadanatva karma, Dachan dosha vittyeke karma prahu Manishina. Some people say that karma causes bondage, therefore it should be given up. And such people say Manishina. Manishina means they are great thinkers, Manishina, they are controllers of their mind, that means they are able to think deeply. So just because they consider that that karma should be given up, Krishna doesn't say that they are Nishkutina or anything. They are also pursuing transcendence. They are also thinking about how to become liberated from material existence. But they have not come up with the best understanding of how to become liberated. If they are also pursuing long-term good, then they are also Mahajanas. So they are also Manishina. Similarly, here the word Mahajana is used to refer to those who are not understanding this paradigma. They are also great suttis. Not that they are demons. So there are multiple levels of dharma, and people who do not understand the highest level of dharma, they are also dharmic. Just like if you have demigod worshippers. Sometimes we become very harsh and judgmental and say that they are worshipping the less intelligent. That is what Krishna says, I have made this. But then, I also, they discussed this last time also. Jalinte Sattvika Devam. Krishna himself in 17th chapter, Jalinte Sattvika Devam Yaksha Raksham Sirasa Kretan Bhuta Ganam Shyam Jalinte Kamasaraja. So he said, those who are Sattvuna worship the Devatas. Those who are Rajoguna, जन्म जाति का देवान यक्षरक्षाम से राजा उस वर्ष यक्षा धन राशि तैयार करके बचो गुण एंड प्रेतान भूत गणाम शांति उस वर्ष प्रेता धन तो तेरे नमो है सो नाउ कृष्ण इज सेइंग दैट दोज आर सत्वगुण वर्षित देवतास नाउ वी ऑफन से ओ दोज वर्ष काली दुर्गा देर तमो दोज वर्ष ब्रह्मा दे रजोगुण दोज वर्ष विष्णु दे सत्वगुण एंड दोज वर्ष कृष्ण दे There are some higher beings and there are virtuous higher beings and to worship them in some way it's in accordance with scripture that requires some level of satyagraha. So we could say that worshipping devatas requires some basic goodness, but within that we could say that there is those who worship Vishnu, they are in like goodness. Those who worship Shiva, worship Brahma, they are in passion goodness. Those who worship Durga Mata, they are in ignorance goodness. Means within goodness only there are greens. But they are all in goodness. Now we see something like this similar in the classification of animals also. We see that, say, the cows are in goodness and animals like monkeys are in passion and donkeys are in ignorance or whatever. We say like that. But you see, at one level this classification is right. But then Krishna himself, at one place, he equates cows and donkeys. So, eva bhogaha yasya buddhi gunapaitita bhoge svabhavam ityadi yasya buddhi gunapaitita bhoge yatita buddhi sarve na karichit janesha buddheshu sa eva bhogaha. So, Krishna is saying that those who think that they are their bodies and that their land of birth is worshipable, those who think that going to holy place is just for bathing, these people are like cows or asses. You say, cows and asses, what big difference are there? Why are you putting both of them together? So it's like all animals are ignorant. Krishna is saying they are ignorant like animals. So he's giving two examples of animals. So all animals are ignorant, but within that, say cows are in goodness ignorance. Lions and tigers are in passion ignorance. Monkeys and donkeys are in ignorance ignorance. So, like that, basically the devata, anybody who worships the devata, they have a certain level of support. That means they are not even worshiping devatas. So you need to appreciate that. But similarly here, there are people who have understanding of lower levels of dharma. They do not have the understanding of Bhagavad Dharma, but even they are called Mahajanas. They are not derided, they are not mocked over here. They are not condemned. They are also appreciating Mahajanas, but they are not having the highest level of dharma. Devya vimohita mati ratamaya dham. Their mati vimohita, their mati is deluded. And normally think if somebody is deluded by maya, they go into adharma. What is happening? So they are deluded by maya and trayam jarikrita mati madhamushpita. Trayam refers to the three Vedas, or it refers to the three dharma, dharmartha kama. And they are attracted by the madhupushpita, the sweet flower-like words of the Veda. So, the word of the Bhagavad Gita is called Yama Pushpita Anubhaja. So, similarly, madhupushpita, the flower-like words of the Veda. What is this flower-like word? This is that we should do this, like nowadays today, Pushpita Anubhaja is all the advertisements. You can get this, you can get this, you can get this sweet connection, you can have this fast computer, you can have this fast car, like this, like this. All this is Pushpita Anubhaja, madhupushpita. So, there are promises of better material comfort, better material pleasures. So, they are attracted by that. Vaitanike mahati karmani yujjamanam. So, mahati karmani, they engage in great rituals. Krishna also talks about it in the sense of Yamma, Pushita, Vasi, Tavadhi, Vashita, Veda, Vada, Dhamma, in the sense of Kamatmana, Swarupa, Janma, Karma, Palata, Kriya, Visheshavana. They perform special rituals. Elaborate which elaborate ceremonies they perform, but it is all for material purposes. So Krishna, as he is saying that, there is this Paradharma and there are others who are also Mahajanas, but they understand the, they don't understand this Dharma. It is mere derailer by Maya. So Vibhidharma Maya is not that they are sinful, but by Vibhidharma Maya is that they are unable to understand the highest Dharma. Desire. bound desires. Bandha Krishna. Normally called bondage. Is that people are bound. But not only by bound desires. That means actually whenever we are attached to something, that attachment restricts the scope of our desires. See, if a person is a drunkard, that person, all of us have free will. We always have free will. That free will is never taken away from anyone. But the more a person becomes attached to something, the scope of their free will becomes less and less. See, now a person who is just never drunk or who is just drunk a few times, it's not addict. The person can choose, should I drink or should I not drink? Because I am not drunk. So now, the habitual drunkard, can they choose? They can also choose. But they will choose, should I drink whiskey or brandy? They can't choose whether I should drink or not. So what has happened? When our attachment to a sense object, it locks our desire in that sense object. And we may have freedom, but say somebody is addicted to TV. Say, okay, I can watch this channel or this channel. But I have to watch TV. So what our attachment to certain object, it restricts the scope of our desire. So Bhagavatam Krishna, our desires become bound. So the more we are attached, the less becomes our scope of freedom. And the lesser freedom, our free will never goes away. But it becomes more and more restricted. Stay grihendranam. So then those people who are bound in their desires, they are the person who are culpable. And they are the person who are under my jurisdiction. Yeah? Bring them to me. And further he stresses that, so it might be physical, a little abstract, and they don't relish the nectar of the lotus feet of God. So then in the next verse, this verse, he makes it more clear. What does it mean? How do you know somebody relish the nectar of the lotus feet of God? Of Lord Hari? Yeah, we may say that's an internal thing. But he uses externals, specific actions. Because you don't do the actions, you can bring them to me.
कृष्णाय
नमः तीयच्छीरहि कदापि कृष्णाय विष्णु He talks about three forms of devotional activities, with the body, with the tongue, and with the mind. Those who don't chant the names, Jivana Bhakti Nakut Kulina Vidhiyam. The tongue doesn't chant the name of the Lord of Lord Hari. So here is not reference specifically to the name, Kulina Vidhiyam, the names, qualities, everything. And the heart doesn't remember Chetasmutu Smarati. They don't remember his lotus feet. And Krishnayana Namati Achyayakata. They never go down. So all these activities can protect us from sins and their sinful reactions. But those who don't believe their activities, Tanayatvam. Again, using the same word, Asato. They are caught in the temporary. And what is Akrutat Vishnu Krutyan? Krutyan refers to that which is to be done. It is a duty. Akruta Vishnu Kutyan means those who have not done their duty to Lord Vishnu. They are culpable. And then we can bring them to me. Now, here Yamaraj completes his instruction to the Yamudras. And now he turns around and he seeks forgiveness from the Lord. So, if we see his reaction, was that initially he was pleased that he had the point to speak to the Lord. But now, after he explained the Dharma, instead of dharma, what happened is his servants, they tried to violate or interrupt the application of a higher dharma. They were also following dharma, but they were following the lower dharma. And by following the lower dharma, they misapplied and they neglected a higher dharma. So, to give a mundane example, suppose say there is a police chowki or there is a toll naka or something like that. And there is some big politician, say the Prime Minister of the country or the Prime Minister of the country, you know, that person is going. And there is some person who doesn't know who is this big politician. And that person tries to extract all or tries to discipline that person. And the boss comes around, hey, what did you do? He's my boss, he's the boss of my boss. And he says, hey, then he will explain the position of that person, that Chief Minister or Prime Minister, then he will ask for doing this. Now please forgive me, please forgive me. So it's like, leave that. I said, what, I made a mistake? It's like my whole department made a mistake. So I'm sorry about that. So like that, he explains to them that because Vishnu is supreme, because his name is so powerful, therefore, actually speaking, by his name, all sins can be removed. And you should not have touched him, not have brought him. But, I mean, confusion and influence so that they don't make a mistake. Do this, don't do this. And now he turns around and seeks forgiveness. He approaches the Lord, prays to him. Please let this be forgiven. So Bhagavan Purusha Purana, that Lord who is eternal supreme, the primeval person. Namarayana Swapurushaya Asatputam. That Asatputam, that wrong individual done by the servants, please forgive that. Swana Mahona Vidushama. They did not know what they were doing. So Rachit Anjali, now I am folding my hands and I am offering forgiveness. Shanti Garesa Nama Purushaya Bhumne. I offer my obeisances to your Lord and it is Shanti Garesa. That means you are such a great person, it befits you to forgive me. It befits you to forgive us, therefore, the bad action that was done by my people, Swana, that you please forgive. So actually, there are two modes of reaction to wrong. There are many modes, but you can have two broad modes. One is vindictiveness and the other is forgiveness. Vindictiveness means, you know, we hit back, we retaliate. Now, you hurt me, I will hurt you. So vindictiveness is basically the revenge on that. And then there is forgiveness. And of course, in between there is justice. Justice should be vindictive. It is at different times, different principles have to apply. So, when the Pandavas fight the war, they are not being vindictive. They are not fighting the war primarily to revenge. So, they have vows that they will, vows they take them and they want to revenge against, take revenge against the honor is not. This honor that has been under the Pandavas properly. But still, in Krishna Bodhi Shantanamrita, they show that they are ready to forgive it all. So their primary purpose was not revenge, their primary purpose was justice. So we can say that one extreme is vindictiveness, the other extreme, not extreme in a bad sense, but if the other point is, if you consider pendulum, vindictiveness, forgiveness and justice. So here we are saying that please forgive. So it is, it behooves a great person to forgive. So he is appealing to the greatness of the Supreme Lord and saying, please forgive them. And then again, after seeking forgiveness like this, again stresses the glory of the holy name, the glory of Bhakti. So well known word, Asmat Sankirtanam Vishnu.
Asmat Sankirtanam Vishnu.
Jagan Mangala Vamhasa.
Jagan Mangala Vamhasa.
Mahatamati Kauravya.
Mahatamati Kauravya.
Vidyai Kantika Nishkritam.
Vidyai Kantika Nishkritam.
Aikantika Nishkritam. Ultimate destruction of anger. Mahatamapi Kauravya. Even if there is a great sin that has committed, the Sankirtana of Vishnu Jagat Mangala Mahasam. It brings auspiciousness in this world and destroys even the greatest of sins. Know it. Please understand. Know it. Understand it. He's telling the sermon that even the greatest of sins, he will destroy the chanting of the holy names. Shunatam Pranatam Viryanyam.
Shunatam Pranatam Viryanyam.
Puttamani Hare Mohamu.
Puttamani Hare Mohamu.
Yatha Sujataya Bhaktya.
Yatha Sujataya Bhaktya.
Shuddhenatma Vratadivhi.
Shuddhenatma Vratadivhi.
So, the Bhagavad Yamaraja also, in one sense, echoing the theme which Shukadeva Goswami spoke earlier. He's saying that by hearing, by chanting, Hare Mohamu, that can counter Sujyadaya Bhakti, which I'm hearing when Bhakti is born, in great sense can be countered by that. And this Krama Shuddhi Nahatma Vratadhi, by doing Vratas, but it involves another form of atonement, that kind of purification cannot happen. The kind of purification that happens by chanting the holy names. It goes further and Krishna Mundi Padma Madhuli Nakuna Vishushka
Krishna Mundi Padma Madhuli Nakuna Vishushka
Maya Vrishuramate Vrijina Vaheshu
Maya Vrishuramate Vrijina Vaheshu
Anyasuka Mahataha Atmaraja Varam Anyasuka Mahataha Atmaraja Pram Rashtu
Anyasuka Mahataha Atmaraja
So he's contrasting two people now, broadly speaking, the devotees and non-devotees. Krishnangri Madhupadma Madhuli, the lotus nectar belongs to the Lord Hari. If those who drink it, na punar visvishtha, and again they do not fall to material existence. Maya Puneshu Ramate Vrijinavaheshu. And they cannot enjoy material existence, they do not fall back to material existence, material enjoyment, like material uses. Anyastu kama mahata. So, anyastu, they are defeated by lust, defeated by selfish desire. Atmaraja, pramashtu, atmaraja. But their self is completely overpowered by the lower ones. So they fall back into karma. So that means that there are two kinds of people. They will try to overcome material desires. So kama hatha, it is said, they will be defeated by lust. That means both of them are trying to fight against lower desires. But one category will not be defeated, another category will be defeated. Now here is talking about something different. Here is not talking about simple reactions. They will be protected from. He's talking about being protected from sinful desires itself. That though the materialistic people, even if they are trying to be spiritual, even if they are trying to become pure, but if they do not drink the nectar of Lord Hari's lotus feet, then kama, they will become defeated again. Even if there is an atonement for becoming free from the wrongdoing that they have done, but still contamination will reappear. Like Ravana said, one head has cut another open, one head has cut another open. Like that will keep coming up. But those who drink the nectar of the Lord Hari, for them, it will not happen again. This may raise a question here. Sometimes when we say that devotees also fall away from the path of Bhakti. So what does it mean when we say that devotees may also sometimes fall away? So what it means is that the soul always has free will. And the free will is never taken away. So no matter how much we advance in bhakti, still we have the option to choose Maya whenever we want. That option never goes away. At the same time, the more we choose Krishna, the more we become habituated to choosing Krishna. The more we choose Maya, the more we become habituated to using Maya. But we always, so when we say we become habituated, what does it mean? It's like say, if this floor is sloping in this direction, then if water is poured over here, water will actually go in this direction. Now, we can make the water go in this direction also, but it requires much greater force. Whereas this floor is sloping, you know, for a sloping floor, we use the word inclination. The floor is inclined in this direction. And inclination also refers to tendency. I have an inclination for this thing. I have an inclination for that thing. The inclination means, that's where our thoughts, our consciousness, our desires automatically goes. Oh, I have an inclination for music. That means my thoughts naturally flow towards music. I can naturally engross to music. So what happens? When a devotee starts practicing bhakti, the consciousness becomes inclined towards Krishna. And that's why the consciousness can flow more easily, more naturally towards Krishna. But still, we always have freedom. And if somebody wants to engage in materialism, that opportunity is always there. But because one has tasted the sweetness of bhakti, one will not be able to enjoy materialistic pleasure so much. One will indulge in it, but at one level we can say there is no pleasure in material existence.
But if one does not know any other pleasure, then the pleasure in mental existence itself appears to be very large.
When I'm not so, it appears to be the only pleasure. Now what Krishna says is that, what is in 16.12?
We experience Krishna. Even if we are attracted to material things, we don't get pleasure. But you see, because they don't know any other pleasure, that's why they're captivated by this pleasure. So if devotees, even if somebody falls back, they cannot last there for very long. Because of using the field in an appropriate way, they try to enjoy again and again and again. But they don't last for very long. And eventually they will find it tasteless and they will come to Krishna. So that option of coming back to Krishna is always there beckoning. So you know there is a conscious desire and a subconscious desire. So even if consciously at the external level, devotee has fallen out of Krishna consciousness, of Lord Bhakti. The devotee could be that ex-devotee, you want to say, that devotee engaging in materialistic activities. But subconsciously, that remembrance of the sweetness of Bhakti is there. And that will beckon, that will beckon. And Krishna will arrange circumstances in such a way that the devotee will come back to Krishna. So in that sense, the completely being lost in material existence will never happen for a devotee. Because Krishna will give the recollection internally, and Krishna will also give the opportunity externally. And that person will come back. But materialistic people have never tasted, for them it is much, much more difficult to come. For them it is like they have to begin from scratch. And it's much more difficult. So, that's 34. Ittham Svabhartru Vaditam Bhagavan Mahitvam.
Ittham Svabhartru Vaditam Bhagavan Mahitvam.
Samskritya-vismidhiyo-yam-kim-karaste Naiva-chutashto-janam-pati-shankamana
Naiva-chutashto-janam-pati-shankamana
Rashtunya-vibhati-tata-prabhuti-smarajan
Rashtunya-vibhati-tata-prabhuti-smarajan
So prabhuti, from that time onwards, vibhati, they are fearful. Yamakim karaste. The Yamutas are fearful that they are Bhagavan Maitu. They understood the glories of the Lord from their own master, Svabhartru Paditam, after he told it to them. Therefore, they remember it, Vismidhyo. They are astonished to hear the glory. The astonishing glory of the Lord has struck with wonder. Naiva Achyuta Ashrayajan. Naiva Achyuta Ashrayajanam. They never approach those who are in the shelter of Achyuta. Pratisangamana, they don't come near them because they are hesitant Yamutas. They don't come, so they have heard the Lord. So here, this is actually speaking, in English, we have direct speech and indirect speech. English, we have, when direct speech is starting, we have double quotes. We have apostrophe, we have two apostrophes indicated, speech is starting and speech is ending. So, Sanskrit is relatively speaking very frugal about punctuation. In English we have semicolon, we have colon, we have hyphen, long dash, short dash, comma, double quotes, single quotes. Sanskrit is, the English word is parsimonious. Parsimonious means use something very frugal. Sanskrit is very parsimonious about use of punctuations. So that's why the grammatical rules are more involved. So the point I am talking about is this, that actually here Yamaraja is finished speaking. This is actually being spoken, Yamaraja has finished his speech, and this is being spoken by Suta Goswami, by Shukadeva Goswami. And he is speaking to all Rajan, he is speaking to Bhagavatam Maharaj that actually Yamadutas never approached from that time onwards. So from that time means from this particular incident of Ajami. So this is not being spoken. So it's not that every time in the Bhagavatam when one person starts speaking, then the word Shukavach or Sutavach may not come on that. We have to look at the context to understand this. So, as a Prabhupada, it's traditionally said that to understand Sanskrit grammar itself takes a long, long time. Why? Because it is a very, there is a lot of variation in word form. It's called inflections. You know, like we have I, me, my. This is like a change form of the word. So, like that in Sanskrit, there are many inflections of words. And the inflections of the words do the work of punctuation. Instead of having punctuation, they have inflection of words. So here what is it? sorry, Krishna is being told that from that time onward, Yamrutas don't approach the Bhaktas, the Vishnu Bhaktas. And now, Shri Krishna said that, I will tell you an ancient story. Now, he's also giving the reference.
Where did I get this story?
From whom? It has the concludes by giving the reference over here. Itihasam yam buriyam. Bhagavan Gurmasambhava.
Kathayam asamalaya.
Asino hari marchayam. This confidential story, secret story, Bhagavan Kumbhasambhava. So here Bhagavan refers to not the Supreme Lord, here refers to the great sage. Then this time it's a little Agastya Rishi. Who is Kumbhasambhava? Whose father was Kumbhava? Was born from Kumbhava. And the Kathayama Asamalaya, on the Malaya hills, he told me the story. Asino Hari Rachayam. There he was residing and there he was worshipping Lord Hari. Shri Swami mentioned his commentary that actually there he had darshan of Lord Hari in Malaya Hills and he touched the lotus feet of Lord Hari again and again, and thus he was profusely blessed as a member of the Rishi, and from him I have heard the story. So he tells the story and gives the reference, and the story gets included over here. So the story, if you look at this chapter, in the same, does remember? In Yamaraja's answer, there are four parts. You remember what the four parts brought him? This is related to their question, the identity of, identity of the law, identity of Narayana, the supreme position, then position of Vishnu Rudras. Yeah, understanding of dharma, that means in that it talks about the paradharma and the aparadharma. Paradharma and the Trivedic dharma. And then it talks about application of dharma, why does it apply in the Rudras. And then he concludes by seeking forgiveness and again, glorifying the path of Bhakti. After that, here we conclude with Sundar Goswami concludes the meditation. So, should we stop here or should we continue with the next chapter? Sometimes we can go over a few verses. Next chapter is mostly story, so it should not be too demanding. Yeah.
There is one verse in Bhagavatam.
This is quoted quite frequently that Vishnu alone can give liberation. This is a position that Prabhupada usually took. But if you look at the Goswamis describe that those who are purely devoted to Shiva, they can be liberated with Shiva. That means now Shiva also has multiple manifestations. There is Rudra who exists in this world. In the Sadashiv, which is at the interface of the material and spiritual world. The Goswami, the Yu Goswami elaborates on this in his Brahma Samhita commentary. He states that actually those who are very purely devoted to Shiva, they can go to the abode of Sadashiva, which is the eternal abode, and there, with Shiva, they will eternally glorify Vishnu. So that means Shiva can become, to some extent, like the eternal spiritual master.
So that, in what cases it will happen, that is something which we cannot get into because he doesn't elaborate over there much. And the point is that it is not so much Shiva himself giving liberation. See, the devatas, basically they perform two different roles. One is the material administrative role, and the second is the spiritual educative role. So usually, most people approach them for the material administrative purpose only. That means, okay, like you have in this position, you have this power, and please give me this, this, this. But in some situations, the devatas also talk about the spiritual educative thing. For example, when we have the Sudarshan Chakra chasing Durvasana. At that time, the devatas say, I cannot help you. When you go to somebody, ultimately they are guiding Vishnu. So, on some occasions, the devatas also, they point people to Vishnu. This is a lot. Shiva is also actually pleased when Mohimur Kumil tells him, and he glorifies Vishnu after that. So, usually speaking, most people, they don't approach devatas for that purpose. We have example Chaitanya-charitamrita of Saraswati Devi saying to Rishikashyapa that my ultimate blessing was not to make you a champion scholar, my ultimate blessing was to make you a devotee of, to introduce you to my Lord, to make him devoted to my Lord. In the, there is also the story of Chandidas. Chandidas is a great Vaishnava poet, and he said Chaitanya Charitamrita in the Devotee. Even Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would hear his compositions, his devotional compositions. He was very pleased to hear those compositions. I just want to wonder if he is a Vaishnava poet, why is his name Chandidas? So actually, the story that earlier was a great version of Chandi, and his brother was a Vishnu. And he was quite wealthy, he had a big beautiful garden, and he would have many many flowers, and those flowers he would offer to Chandi. So one day his brother asked him, can I take this one flower for offering to my Shalini? No, all the flowers are meant only for the goddess. So his brother did not insist, but he was sad. And the next morning when he woke up and he was just coming back from bathing, he looked at the flowers, very beautiful. And his mind, he thought, it's so nice, he would offer it to Vishnu. And his mind, he did Manas Puja, he offered to Vishnu. And then, Chandidas took that same flower and he offered it to Chandi. And then as he was chanting, the Chandi prayer, suddenly Chandi appeared to him, he said, please, what do you want? He was very delighted. He asked, I have been offering the same prayer so long. How is it today you have become pleased? He says, today you have given me the Mahaprasad of my Lord. He says, what do you mean? And she told him about this flower and offered the mind to Vishnu. He says, does that mean that Vishnu is your Lord? And Vishnu is greater than you? He says, of course. He says, Vishnu is the Lord of my Lord. My Lord is Shiva and the Lord is Vishnu. So at that time, he says, then why did you ever tell this to me? She never asked this to me. You were only asking for give me this, give me that, give me that. You never asked me this. Today because you offered me this Mahaprabhu, my Lord, and he me. So from that point onward, he started taking her as his guru. So she directly to Vishnu. That's why his name remains Chandidas, but he was Vaishnava. So it was from his birth and from his birth. Initially he was a Vaishnava Chandi, but the same Chandi has his guide, spiritual guide. He became a Vaishnava. So this is of course not exactly a story of somebody becoming liberated because of the worship, this is the devata. But the point is that the devatas also have this spiritual educative role. But most of the time they don't perform a function in that role. They function in the material administrative role. So with respect to Shiva, because he also has eternal manifestation in Sadashiva, so there is the possibility that those who worship him purely, they can go to his eternal abode and there with him, they eternally become devoted to Vishnu. Yes.
Devotionally applies to Lord Krishna. But there are like problems there, especially in the south, there is like a few bhakti movement for Lord Shiva also, kind of counter to whatever. So, like, how do we understand? Because there is like, they also have the saying of like servant of the servant. Of like aspiring to serve Krishna, serve Lord Shiva without any other aspiration. All these kinds of sentiments they also have. So how do you understand that?
There is a whole movement of action for Lord Shiva, where also there is an aspiration of servant, servant, and in this aspiration of being pure servants of Lord Shiva. So how do you understand it? See, there are, firstly, when we say that, say the worshippers of Brahma are in passion, or the worshippers of Shiva are in ignorance, or those are the ignorance worship Shiva, we have to understand that any kind of taxonomy is a system of classification. It is never watertight. It is not that, never watertight. It is not that, you know, anybody who is not a worshipper of Shiva, anybody who is not in the Bhagavatam cannot worship Lord Shiva. The thing is that broadly, the Lord Shiva his appearance, his activities, they are described in such a way, or he acts in such a way, that he attracts even people in the Bhagavatam. But that does not mean that every single of his worshipper has to be Bhagavatam. Sometimes, some people may themselves from their previous lives may have over Sattvic orientation, and if they are born in a family which is Shiva worshipper, or they are born in a place where the Lord Shiva worship, then they may start Shiva worship. So individually, there may be people in Sattvic also who may be worshipping Lord Shiva, but that may be from various other factors by which they can be worshipping. So it is not that firstly that all worshippers of Shiva have to be in Tamaguna only. They can be in various modes, but that is the broad category of whom I will be attracted to the worship of Lord Shiva. Certainly, as far as the aspiration for pure devotion is concerned, Shiva, there is a huge Shaiva movement. And they said that the Alwar, they are called Nayanwars. They are also great Shiva saints, Shaivite saints. And they have some many compositions and written a beautiful poetry to fulfill Lord Shiva. So, at one level, we understand this is also a part of the Vedic program. In the sense that the devatas are also represented to the Supreme Lord, and they are empowered by the Supreme Lord to become, to be worshipable beings. That's what Krishna said, right? Tam tam yoyo yamyatan bhakti lagyashu chitasakasya achalam shantam tam eva vidhamyam. So it is I who give them the faith, I will give the conviction by which they can become fixed in their devotion. And 7.20 says, whatever they want to worship, whichever form they want to worship, I make their faith strong. So actually, Prabhupada completely adds the full sentence in that translation. He says, I am the super soul present in everyone's heart. Now there is no mention of super soul in that verse at all. Prabhupada says, as the super soul present in the heart, I give them conviction. I make their faith strong so that they can worship themselves. So the Vedic program is that when, now this verse, Madhacharya explains that actually how Krishna does that, that if somebody wants to worship a particular devata, he arranges for them to get attracted to that sangha and that shastra which will glorify that devata. And that's how their shraddha becomes strong. So for those who want to worship Lord Shiva, there is that kind of sangha of Shaivites, there is that kind of shastra, the Shaivashiva Puran and other Purans, and by which they will also become attracted and they will become convinced in that. So, this is also a part of the Vedic program for elevation. And as they become devoted to Lord Shiva, it is possible that they will become attracted to him, and Lord Shiva also has the potency to purify. Now, he may not have the potency to completely purify of all desires, in the sense of ultimately landing liberation. But still, by worshipping him also, people can become purified. And they may also, what to speak of Lord Shiva, sometimes even in this world, there are people sometimes love selflessly. Most often the love is selfish, but it's not that in principle, selfless love is not possible at all. Sometimes say a mother being ready to sacrifice her life for a child, or people are ready to sacrifice their love for the nation. You may say it's extreme selfishness. But at one level, it does appear selfless. They are able to give up their things. So, the point is that Krishna, yadya vibhuti matsatvam shrimadurujitam eva tatta deva vachitam udehinam shrimadurujitam eva. Everything attractive manifests the spark of Krishna's splendor.
Sometimes some spark can manifest attractive splendor that people just get captivated by it. There was a famous American patriot. He said, the only regret in my life is that I have only one life to serve America.
So that is extinct to me. America is just one country. You know, somehow Krishna can attract. It is a spark of Krishna manifestation that is manifested in an attractive way for that person to become so totally devoted. So if even if for such largely material manifestations, people can become so attracted. And what to speak of those who are actually connected with Krishna, those who are servants of Krishna, people can become attracted to them. So that intense selfless devotion or pure devotion or the aspiration for humility and service attitude, that can manifest even towards some devotas. It's not impossible. Prabhupada has asked this question in South India, judge in Chennai. And so Prabhupada said that normally when one goes to a bar, it is for drinking. But sometimes when they go to a bar, you want to rescue somebody who is drunk. So, but that is the exception. So he says, normally people who worship Lord Shiva, they are intoxicated by material desires. But sometimes it's possible that some people may worship without any intoxication. They may be pure and they will be worshipping by purity. And sometimes by their association, others may also become pure to some extent. So we can't reduce anything in the material world to only a particular category. That category is a broad defining characteristic. But it is not an absolute limiting characteristic. So in some cases, it is possible that some people may aspire for pure devotion. This is two ways it is a part of the Vedic system. One is, one way it is a part of the Vedic system because devotees are empowered to receive worship from Krishna. Krishna is the way it is. And secondly, Krishna manifests. It's only manifesting that attract people so much. So why can't they attract people devotees also? Does that answer your question?
Yes, how they can worship Lord Krishna. But in these cases, we see, especially in this moment, not he gives darshan or there are so many miracles, but and still their faith in him only gets stronger, and they even have darshans or there are various details. So, he could have revealed that I am also a devotee of Krishna, and he could have directed them to Lord Krishna.
So, Kant Lord Shiva directed his worshippers towards Vishnu. Yes, that's possible. At the same time, it's how different people will be elevated at different times that can vary according to the circumstances. We see that the Bhagavatam, it is not very judgmental about it, in the sense that it is like Shami Krishi was an impersonalist. In the first canto it mentions, he was like more like a moralist. But the Bhagavatam is not condemning any of the following fools and rascals or anything like that. Or it is a part that Bhagavatam gives a mission, he was an impersonalist, but afterwards he became an idiot. We didn't go into that kind of thing at all. So, yes, the Bhagavatam does describe that Shukadeva Goswami was an impersonalist and became a devotee, and is glorified. And that is revealed as a glory of not just Shukadeva Goswami. What's up the glory of the Supreme Lord? Atma Ramashima Yodhagantha Pyodhagantha. So, the point is that the Bhagavatam, there is clarity about the ultimate goal, but there is no insecurity about others following other roads. See, what happens is when our faith is not very strong, you know, our certainty depends on being able to convince others also about the certainty. So if we feel that if I am worshipping Vishnu, Krishna, I don't even worship Krishna. Why is it anybody else worshiping? Where others worshiping someone else? So the Bhagavatam does tell us some stories where, as I said, the Vishnu Lord Shiva guides the Prachitas towards Vishnu. But it is not that if we look at the Bhagavatam or the Ramayana or the Mahabharata, it is not described that wherever everyone was, everyone became a Vishnu. Chaitanya would be say that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went to Shivakanchi or wherever people became Vaishnavas. But Shivakanchi still existed and it is fulfilled with Shiva worshippers only.
So maybe at that time people became devotees. But even after they became devotees, there is no description. For example, say that Keshav Kashmiri officially joined the Vaishnava Sampradaya. Not Keshav Kashmiri. Prakash Kamsar officially joined the Vaishnava Sampradaya. Or Keshav Kashmiri, you know, he did not join Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's Sampradaya. He went on to the Vallabh Sampradaya. And he became an exalted scholar and commented to Bhagavatam, became his commentary. So the point is that in general, I'm giving the example of the Bhagavatam as well as the later tradition, that it is not that everybody is out of an agenda to convert everyone from their affiliation to higher affiliation. So people will progress at their pace. And sometimes you may be part of the Lord's plan, that Hindus are worshipping Lord Shiva. Lord Shiva will sometimes reveal himself as a devotee to them, and sometimes he may not. So there are many factors at work which we are not aware of. And we may have got the expressway for going towards Krishna, but that doesn't mean everything has to necessarily be on that expressway. Other people may be going through ways, other things like they may have their own visions, their own darshans, and they may have a plan for their own elevation also. Does that address your question? Any other questions?
When Yamaraja is describing the glories of the holy name, in this translation of verse number 34, the young Buddhas were struck with wonder, and since then, as soon as they see a devotee, they fear him and dare not. When hearing the description of the glories of the holy name and understanding the glories of the devotees, what kind of fear or what kind of dare not coming in front of the devotees were described here? Is it the fear of, you know, it is very much afraid? They are afraid of the devotee, or what kind of fear is there?
So we said the Amudas are afraid to approach a devotee. Now, why exactly? What is the nature of their fear? See, fear means that everybody has a particular function. Yamadutas have their own role to perform in this world. And while performing their role, it is that they understand that the Yamadutas are not under our jurisdiction. Yamadutas are not exactly, they are also within the broad framework of Dharma. They are also acting as agents of Yamaraja. But they are not exactly like spiritual sadhakas who are eager for devotee association. It's not like that. It's like say there's a police officer. A police officer is the government, and then somebody comes to know, okay, this person is a big politician, this person is a big so and so, whatever. Then even in place, say airport security, somebody is a very big person, say, you don't have to scrutinize them. You should approach them. That means that they are not within their jurisdiction. The fear means that we cannot apply our authority to them. So it is not that they are afraid in the sense that the devotees are going to curse us and they are going to be punished or something like that. That is not the kind of fear. The fear basically means that our jurisdiction does not extend to them. Therefore, we cannot impose our authority on them. And that's why they keep a distance from the devotees. So in that sense, they are afraid that if they mistakenly apply the jurisdiction of the devotees, then that will be, they have had the experience of them being rebuffed, they are being defeated, and that's why they don't want to mistakenly apply the jurisdiction of the devotees. Does that answer your question? So thank you very much. Grantha Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Jai.